Jesus the Nazarene. So please take your feet and we'll sing. Take your feet and stand, or sit and stand, or do something this morning. Don't take your feet. But stand on your feet if you can. And we'll sing, "I Stand Amazed in the Presence."
Please be upstanding.
Oh,
Calvary and suffered and died alone.
This morning, we're delighted to be gathered together to praise, to worship, and to glorify you. Father, we pray that you'd meet with us this morning, and that Father, we would know you more, and Father, we would understand more about what the Lord Jesus has done for us, and how wonderful He really is. We said at another meeting yesterday, we were reminded, could anything good come out of Nazareth? And we thought about that, and we reminded ourselves that the best thing came out of Nazareth, and that was the Lord Jesus Himself. And that's why we're here this morning, Lord. We just thank you for all the things you've done. We thank you that you love us so much. For those who aren't with us at the moment, Lord, we just pray that you would help them where they are, whether they are sick, or maybe they're at work, or they have other duties to do, Lord. We pray that you would be with them. We think about the women who are away at the weekend on Aran, and how they will be returning home today. Give them safe travel back. In Jesus' name. Amen. So there's a few notices to go through this morning, which we'll try and get through. We also have our communion service in the service today as well, so it'd be lovely for you guys to join in. If you love the Lord Jesus and you know Him as your Lord and Saviour, we'll be happy to break bread with you, I'm sure. As you can see, there is the church lunch today, which is right after the meeting, and we will give you a wee bit of guidance about that when the time comes, as to when the folks are ready to allow you to eat. And as normal, we will probably go out that side door there to get our food and our drinks, and then have a time of fellowship together. We want to remind folks of the AGM on Thursday. Now, if you're on email, you might have already received some of the information regarding the AGM. If you've not, or you don't have any email facility, please speak to Ken. He'll be happy to help you and give you some paper copies of what the AGM will consist of. We'd all like to remind you also of the McMullen Coffee Morning on Saturday, and to remind you all as well that the joint prayer meeting will still be here on Saturday in one of the back rooms there. Been asked to, or asked you guys to bear in mind a few other people at this time, especially Joy, who has had a recent bereavement. She's currently in South Africa, and she's needing some prayer and support for her family, and there's some issues with her passport, and I think the authorities are quite slow over there to get things progressed. So if you could bear her in mind, that would be good, and pray that the Lord would help and speed things up as well. We've also been informed this morning that Muriel McCauley had a fall and she's bruised her face and she had been in hospital, but she's now at home. So please pray for Muriel as well. I've been asked to read out a wee card from Irene, and it says, "Dear Bethesda family, I just want to say a very big thank you for the many cards and flowers and gifts and good wishes I received on the occasion of my 80th birthday. I've been extremely blessed and touched by your display of affection for me, with grateful thanks again, Irene." So thank you for that lovely card, Irene. If we go on to our next slide, is there someone that could maybe pop that over for me? Yeah, there we go. There's Margaret. Just to let you know, Margaret's been getting some exercise. Ken sent me a wee photo there. So counting the steps there, Ken, getting the heart rate up a wee bit to help our recovery. So she's looking well, and we're happy to see Margaret up and about, certainly, at the moment. Now, it's because they've got a lot happening today in the service, we're going to get right on and sing our next song. After that song, we will sing another song. And during that time, if the folks want to go to their Bible class or creche, then that would be good. Could I just remind folks to pick their kids up quick from the creche because of the lunch that's being prepared as well after the meeting. So, but we're going to stand and we're going to sing, there's a place where the streets shine with the glory of the Lamb. Thank you.
Please be upstanding.
Because of you.
want to take their kids to the creche, and if the Bible class wants to go out, that's great. We are now going to sing Ascribe Greatness to Our God, the Rock. And then after that, we'll sing Rock of Ages, and we will ask Jim to come and speak to us after that. Okay, thank you.
Side for
Good morning. So, good morning. We've been working our way through Exodus, by no means in detail, just a very general overview, but this will be the sort of last study at the moment in Exodus. We're going to take an exit from Exodus next week. Please be here. We've got a really good speaker, Dr. Riaz Muhammad, and he's going to be telling his story of conversion. He's written a book called What's Up, Doc? A Surgeon's Story, and really looking forward to having him with us next Sunday. So please be here. You'll be sorry if you miss this one. Just also encourage you to pray for the family of Elian and a young schoolgirl that was murdered brutally on their way to school in Croydon this week. Her father, Dr. Michael Andam, has written about 17 Bible books, and they're a keen Christian family, and we pray for them regardless of that, but please pray for them. Let's just take a moment to reflect on that and pray for the family at this time. Thank you. We'll turn to Exodus chapter 32, and I'm going to read the whole chapter. It's quite a long reading, so if you bear with me, that'd be great. Now, when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down from the mountain, the people assembled about Aaron and said to him, "Come, make us a God who will go before us. As for Moses, the man who brought us up from the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." Aaron said to them, "Tear off the gold earrings which are in the ears of your wives, your sons, your daughters, and bring them to me." Then all the people tore off the gold rings which were in the ears and brought them to Aaron. He took them, took this from their hand and fashioned it with a graving tool and made it into a molten calf. And they said, "This is your God, O Israel, who brought you up from the land of Egypt." Now when Aaron saw this, he built an altar before it, and Aaron made a proclamation and said, "Tomorrow shall be a feast to the Lord." So the next day they rose up early and offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings, and the people sat down to eat and to drink and rose up to play. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, "Go down at once, for your people whom you brought up from the land of Egypt have corrupted themselves. They have quickly turned aside from the way which I commanded them. They have made for themselves a molten calf and have worshipped it and have sacrificed to it and said, 'This is your God, O Israel, who brought you up from the land of Egypt.' The Lord said to Moses, 'I have seen this people, and behold, they are an obstinate people. Now then, let me alone, that my anger may burn against them and that I may destroy them, and I will make of you a great nation.' Then Moses entreated the Lord and said, 'O Lord, why does your anger burn against your people, whom you have brought out from the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians speak, saying, "With evil intent he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and to destroy them from the face of the earth"? Turn from your burning anger and change your mind about doing harm to your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, to whom you swore by yourself and said to them, 'I will multiply your descendants as the stars of the heavens, and all this land of which I have spoken I will give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever.' So the Lord changed his mind about the harm which he said he would do to his people." Then Moses turned and went down from the mountain with the two tablets of the testimony in his hand, tablets which were written on both sides. They were written on one side and the other. The tablets were God's work, and the writing was God's writing engraved on the tablets. Now, when Joshua heard the sound of the people as they shouted, he said to Moses, "There is a sound of war in the camp." But he said, "It's not the sound of the cry of triumph, nor is it the sound of the cry of defeat, but the sound of singing I hear." It came about as soon as Moses came near the camp that he saw the calf and the dancing. And Moses' anger burned, and he threw the tablets from his hand and shattered them at the foot of the mountain. He took the calf which he which they had made, and burned it with fire, and ground it to powder, and scattered over the surface of the water, and made the sons of Israel drink it. Then Moses said to Aaron, "What did this people do to you that you have brought such great sin upon them?" Aaron said, "Do not let the anger of my Lord burn. You know the people yourself, that they are prone to evil. For they said to me, 'Make a God for us who will go before us.' For this Moses, the man who brought us up from the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." I said to them, "Whoever is gold, let them tear it off." So they gave it to me, and I threw it in the fire, and out came this calf. Now when Moses saw that the people were out of control, for Aaron had let them get out of control to be a derision among their enemies, then Moses stood in the gate of the camp and said, "Whoever is for the Lord, come to me." And all the sons of Levi gathered together to him. He said to them, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, every man of you put his sword upon his thigh and go back and forth from gate to gate in the camp and kill every man his brother and every man his friend and every man his neighbor." So the sons of Levi did as Moses instructed, and about 3,000 men of the people fell that day. Then Moses said, "Dedicate yourselves today to the Lord, for every man has been against his son and against his brother, in order that he may bestow a blessing upon you today." On the next day, Moses said to the people, "You yourselves have committed a great sin, and now I am going up to the Lord. Perhaps I can make atonement for your sin." Then Moses returned to the Lord and said, "Alas, this people has committed a great sin, and they have made a god of gold for themselves. But now, if you will forgive their sin, and if not, please blot me out from your book which you have written." The Lord said to Moses, "Whoever has sinned against me, I will blot out of my book. But go now, lead the people where I told you. Behold, my angel shall go before you. Nevertheless, in the day when I punish, I will punish them for their sin." Then the Lord smote the people because of what they did with the calf which Aaron had made. Amen. Now, you may recall a couple of sessions ago, we considered the fact that Moses went up the mountain and all the people stayed in the camp and they could not go near the mountain. And Moses was up there for a period of 40 days. And they were waiting, and the people saw that Moses was delayed to come down from the mountain. And the people decided to have a meeting with Aaron, who was Moses' brother. He was left in charge of the people while Moses went up to the mountain. And now, the instruction, the last command that was given to them in Exodus 24 before Moses went up the mountain was, "Wait here for us until we come back for you." Just wait, be patient. But the people were not patient. And, it's probably an example of impatience when Moses, earlier in the story, remember, he saw an Egyptian beating up a Hebrew slave, and he went and he intervened, and he thought that he could trigger God's timetable. And sometimes we get fed up waiting on God, don't we? Why is God taking so long? King Saul, he was told to wait before he offered a sacrifice, but, you know, time was moving on, so he offered the sacrifice and disobeyed God. Abraham was told he was going to have a son, and he waited many years, and there was no son arrived, so he devised his own plan, and he had a son called Ishmael. And as a result of that, we have trouble even today in the Middle East because of the sin of Abraham not waiting on God. A missionary called Hudson Taylor said, "It's not lost time to wait upon God. It's not only God's ways, but God's timing." A lot of people are saying, even today, as predicted in 2 Peter chapter 3, mockers are saying, you know, where is the promise of his coming? Jesus said he would come again, and everything's just continuing as it was in the past. There's no change. And Peter writes, and he says, "The Lord is not slow about his promise, but is patient toward you, not wishing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come." And the reason there is a delay is in God's plan. He wants to be merciful and extend the day of salvation to us. But the people were not only impatient, they wanted action now. They said, come, make us a God who will go before us. They wanted to create a God of their own. Now, the Ten Commandments, which had been spoken back in Exodus chapter 20, you know, the first three commandments are, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image, an idol. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. And so the commandments are there. But what the people said in Exodus 24 when they heard this was, you know, whatever, we will do everything the Lord has commanded. And they repeated that, we will do everything the Lord has commanded. And they were protesting that they would be obedient. But now, in Exodus chapter 32, they say, come make us a God who will go before us. And instead of thinking about the fact that God had delivered them, they were beginning to think that Moses had delivered them. They become man-centered. Moses, the man who brought us up from the land of Egypt. There's a great danger for each of us, you know, concentrating on a man and being dependent on each other. You know, our dependence is upon God. But Aaron said, you know, tear off the golden earrings and your wife and the wives of your ears, your sons and your daughters, and bring them to me. And they tore off the golden earrings that they had and brought to Aaron. Now, they had gold earrings, and you remember last week we were talking about a tabernacle, the tent, and in it were many golden pieces of furniture and so on. And this gold could have been used for the furniture in the tabernacle, for the golden altar and the golden altar of incense and so on. There was a lot of gold required. And in Exodus 25 that we read last week, you know, the instruction was, tell the Israelites to bring me an offering. These offerings that have to be received are gold and silver and bronze. And instead of using the gold for God's service, they used it, you know, to build an idol. I suppose we can be very critical of them. But, you know, God's given us all resources. And perhaps a wee look at our bank statement would perhaps indicate, you know, where we put the emphasis. Jesus said, where your heart is, there will your treasure be also. And, you know, if it says, I give £50 to Christian work and £300 I spend on pop concerts and season tickets and Sky TV and all these kind of things, that perhaps indicates, you know, where the emphasis on our lives lie, you know, the resources that could be used in God's service, you know, are diverted elsewhere, and we make gods for ourselves. And there is, you know, the great danger of consumerism and so on. William Cowper says, the dearest idol I have known, whate'er that idol be, help me to tear it from thy throne and worship only thee. And so they brought this gold to Aaron, and he took it from their hands, and he fashioned it, he shaped it with a graving tool, and he made it into a molten calf. Now, I want you to remember this slide, because it's relevant later on. This is what Aaron did. He carefully molded a calf. And you would wonder why he would mold a calf. Well, the Egyptians had a god called Apis, and they worshipped this golden calf in the land of Egypt. I suppose that even today, a large percentage of the world population ye worship cattle, don't they? Here in Hindu countries, these cattle run about free and they give great prominence to them. But, you know, why they would turn from the living God to worship a beast, it's mind-blowing, isn't it? G.K. Chesterton said, when men choose not to believe in God, they do not thereafter believe in nothing. They then become capable of believing in anything. And we live in a society where, you know, we can't, with any freedom, say God, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And what we're told is, you know, out there, we not only have a universe, but we've got multiverses. And somewhere in one of these multiverses, there's a planet just like Earth. And somehow, you know, a spore from that planet landed in our Earth. And it landed and it created all the life that there is nowadays and the diversity of it and the detail of it and so on. And that is what is accepted rather than just realize that God is a great artificer. He is a great designer. He is the creator of the heavens and the earth. Romans chapter 1 says, claiming to be wise, they became fools. Instead of worshiping the glorious ever-living God, they worshiped idols made to look like mere reptiles and birds and animals and reptiles. And we bow these days and worship, you know, pop stars and film stars. And the truth is that every one of them is mortal. And we are learning, you know, that the captains of British industry and the CBI and heads of companies like BP and newsreaders and so police and bankers and politicians and so on, that every one of us has clay, feet of clay. We cannot worship people, we cannot worship things because things change and things deteriorate rather than worship God. And they said to Aaron, this is your God, O Israel, who brought you up from the land of Egypt. Now, when Aaron saw this, he built an altar before it, and Aaron made a proclamation and said, tomorrow shall be a feast to the Lord. And he wanted to get some balance in things. You know, today we worship the golden calf. Tomorrow there will be a feast to the Lord, and that will placate God. That makes things equal, doesn't it? And we have in this sort of attitude permeating society, let's have, you know, God as we know, Jehovah, Elohim, let's have him. But, you know, alongside him, let's have the gods of Allah and Baal and, you know, all the Hindu gods and so on. And, you know, that is not good enough for God. There is one God. So the next day they rose up early and offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings, and the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. And instead of being a feast to God, it turned into an orgy. And they just went wild and they feasted and so on. And the analysis, Stephen repeats this story in Acts chapter 7, and he said the real problem was that their hearts had turned back to Egypt. They didn't worship God because they didn't have it in their hearts. And that is the only way to worship God, is when we approach him with a heart for him, with a clean heart, a devotion. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart. And with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. But their hearts were lying back in Egypt, and they celebrated and they danced and they were become euphoric in terms of their celebration. And Paul says in 1 Corinthians 10, when he looks back on this, he says, now these things occurred as an example for us, to keep us from setting our hearts on evil things, Do not be idolaters as some of them were. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and got up to indulge in revelry. Psalm 106 says they soon forgot what God had done and did not wait for his plan to unfold. In the desert, they give in to their craving. In the wilderness, they put God to the test. So he gave them what they asked for, but sent a wasting disease among them. Back to our passage in Exodus 32, verse 7 says, "Then the Lord God said to Moses, 'Go down at once, for your people whom you brought up from the land of Egypt have corrupted themselves.'" Even before Moses became aware, even before there was a plan of salvation in place, God knew about it and he was anticipating what was going to happen. He says to Moses, "They have quickly turned aside from the way I commanded them. They have made for themselves a molten calf and have worshipped it and sacrificed to it and said, 'This is your God, O Israel, who brought you up from the land of Egypt.'" Just 6 weeks before or so, God had brought them through the Red Sea and given them deliverance. And here they are, they have turned and they have quickly forgotten that God was in charge. It's amazing, isn't it? Probably 50% of the population here will know what I'm talking about when I talk about football managers. That 1 week, they cry out the name of the football manager and he's a great celebrity because the team have won a game. And then the papers on Monday are, the next week are, "Sack the manager." He says, "We'll see what happens." But the people in Exodus, God said in Exodus chapter 3, "When you have brought people out of Egypt, you shall worship God at this mountain." And this mountain that Moses had learned about earlier in his life was probably the mountain at which they were committing this great sin. God says, "I have seen the people. They are obstinate people. They're not malleable. They're obstinate. They're hard in their ways. Now let me alone, that my anger may burn against them, that I may destroy them, and I will make of you a great nation. I'm going to do away with the nation that has descended from Abraham, and you will be the father of this nation." Might have been tempting for somebody of lesser caliber to, you know, have this great status, you know, to be the Moses was going to be the new Abraham. And, you know, it does sound harsh, and sometimes we're afraid to read verses like this from the Bible, aren't we? Because the kind of God that we want to contemplate is the cosmic Santa Claus. He'll just bring your presents at Christmas anyway, you know, even although your room's not tidy, he'll still come. And he'll wink, and everything will be fine on the night. That is the image we have of God, but the real reality is we deal with a holy, holy, holy God. He's a God of wrath, the God of anger. And we'll talk about how that anger is directed later for us. I used to be in interview panels quite frequently for jobs. And you know, one of the things that you should do if you're an interview panel is ask an unexpected question, because usually people come with prepared answers, you know. And I used to ask the question of most candidates, "When was the last time you were angry?" And a lot of people said, "Oh, I'm never angry," which was the wrong answer. Do you not get angry about injustice? About seeing
you know, people oppressed, and the sale of human bodies and human trafficking and all that kind of thing. Does that make you angry? Jesus went into the temple, and it should have, you know, been a prayer meeting on, but he saw, rather than it being a house of prayer, people were selling merchandise and they were exchanging money and they were cheating people and so on. And he went in and he overthrew the tables. He said, "Get out of here. My Father's house is a house of prayer." But God was angry when he saw the people bowing down to this golden calf and worshiping it and ascribing to this golden calf the salvation from the land of Egypt. Moses bowed down and entreated the Lord his God. And he said, "Oh Lord, why does your anger burn against your people, whom you have brought out from the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand?" This is the first of four prayers of Moses in these chapters. And he recognizes that, you know, this has been God's work. It's your people. You have brought them out of the land of Egypt. And he was interested in God's reputation. He didn't say, "Oh, well, wipe them out and make of me a great nation." But he was interested in the people and God's reputation. He said, "If you wipe them out, the Egyptians are going to laugh and they're going to say, what a mess that God has made. He brought them out of the land of Egypt and here they are. They're dead in the wilderness. Turn from your burning anger and change your mind about doing harm to your people." And Paul and Moses was interceding for the people. And he repeats back to God his promises. He says, "Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel. And you promised them long time ago that you would give them this land and you would lead your people and it would be Abraham's descendants that you would bless." And that's a good practice in prayer, to quote back to God the scriptures, his promises, and rely on them. So the Lord changed his mind about the harm which he said he would do to his people. Now, we could probably spend an hour today on talking about the subject, does prayer change God's mind? And rather than do that, I see we've got Gordon Weir with us today, so ask him after the service all about that. But no, I would love to spend the time with you. It's a great study. I would recommend some material to you by Don Carson on this subject if you're interested in following up. But to do justice to it, I would need to spend quite a long time on it. But, you know, God listened to the prayer of Moses and it pleased him. And Moses interceded. Then Moses turned and went down from the mountain with two tablets of the testimony in his hand, tablets on which were written on both sides. They were written by God's writing engraved on the tablets. And Moses went down with the law, and they heard a noise in the camp, and it was indistinguishable. And Moses, as soon as he came near the camp, he saw the calf, he saw the dancing and the music, and he threw down the tablets from his hands and they shattered them at the foot of the mountain. And it was symbolic. This is the first time it was, these commandments were the law, and he broke the law. They smashed there because man could not keep that law. And he took the calf which they had made and burned it with fire, ground it to powder and scattered it on the water and made the sons of Israel drink it. You see, perhaps you might have said, well, he should have kept the gold and used that for the tabernacle. But God is a holy God. He would not recycle something that had been offered to an idol before him. Then Moses said to Aaron, "What did this people do to you that you have brought such great sin upon them. And three times over, he uses this expression, a great sin, a great sin, a great sin. Uncomfortable hearing for Aaron and the people. Thank God we've such a great salvation. That's what we're interested in this morning, isn't it? And Aaron said, do not let your anger of my Lord burn you. And he began to get excuses. You know the people yourself, they are prone to evil, for they said to me, make us a god of gold, etc. And I simply responded, and I threw it in the fire. I threw this gold in the fire, and out came a calf. Now, you know, the dog ate my homework is probably as good an excuse as this one. You know, I just threw it in. You remember what I told you to remember this slide? He took from their hand and fashioned it with a graven tool and molded it into a calf. That he was guilty, but he tried to deflect. And that's, you know, the story since the fall of man. When God challenged Adam about why he had taken the forbidden fruit, he said, the woman that you gave me gave it to me, and I ate. And he said to the woman, what have you done? She said, well, it was the serpent that deceived me, and I ate. You know, everyone else has got great sin, but, you know, we try and excuse it in ourselves, don't we? And Aaron was a man of weakness. It says, Moses saw that the people were out of control, for Aaron let them get out of control to be a derision among their enemies. It's always a great challenge for any leader, you know, to stand for the things of God. It's a great demand these days for this kind of message. God is madly in love with you. His universe revolves around you. God's not angry with your sin. And people want to hear pleasant things. But, you know, Moses had to challenge the people about their sin. And none of us like to hear that kind of message. But he challenged them, and then he laid out this division. He said, whoever is for the Lord, come to me. It's decision time. Are you going to come to this side and take your stand with the Lord? Who is on the Lord's side? Who will serve the King? Decision time. And so the sons of Levi and others gathered together to him, and they made the choice for the Lord. And then there was a slaughter in the camp of those ringleaders in this plot. But Moses said, you know, you yourselves have committed a great sin, and now I am going up to the Lord. Perhaps I can make atonement for your sin. Moses was going to intercede. He was going to pray before the Lord. I'm going up before the Lord. Such merciful words. Perhaps I can make atonement. We talked about that last week. Perhaps I can make atonement for your Lord. And he comes and he pleads with God. He says, but now if you will forgive their sin. And if not, blot me out from your book which you have written. In other words, I want to die if you don't forgive their sin. I'm not interested in becoming, you know, a leader of a father of the nation. I want to die. I'd rather die than see these people. Have you ever felt like that, interceding for people? Tim Keller said that when you become a parent, you're only ever after that going to be as happy as your least happy child. And there's some truth in that, isn't there? that we pray for their families and so on. We'd rather take their place. When you see them get into hospital for an operation, you would rather, you know, be there yourself. And this was the great empathy of Moses, that he would rather that he suffer than these people suffer. This is what Paul said in Romans chapter 9. He had a great love for the people. He said, "My heart is filled with bitter sorrow and unending grief for my people, my Jewish brothers and sisters. I would be willing to be forever cursed, cut off from Christ, if that would save them." He wanted to stand in their place, if he could take their place. Praise God, this morning we have a Savior who has taken our place. He's looked upon our great sin. He sees our wickedness, and he has said, you know, let me stand in their place. Let me stand in Jim McClatchy's place, because he deserves the judgment of God and the wrath of God. But the Lord Jesus says, I will take his punishment. I will bear his sin. I will die in his place. And that's only half the story. Not only does he take our place, but he brings us to his place. There's a place where the streets shine with the glory of the Lamb. There's a way we can go there. We can live there beyond time. Because of you. Because of you. Because of your love. Because of your blood. All my sins are washed away, and I can live forever. Now we have this hope because of you. I was going to get into the next chapter a wee bit, but I see time has gone, and I'll stop there. Perhaps we'll pick up it again. Whose side are you on? And I realize today that I've talked about sin, I've talked about God's wrath. But I've also tried to show you how the wrath of God was poured out on the Lord Jesus Christ when he took our place. And that is why we have such a good news story. Whose side are you on? Are you on the Lord's side? Will you worship him? Amen.
Thank you, Jim. A lot to think about there, isn't there? But Jim shared with us many points in such a large portion of Scripture, and I'm sure we could all mull over that in the week to come. We are going to come into our time of communion now, and I just wanted to share one or two verses from a psalm as we prepare our hearts to be before the Lord this morning in communion. And Jim pointed out something at the start of his sermon there regarding the inability of man to wait patiently. Give us a new God. Give us a God that we can worship. In Psalm 40 it says this: I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to me and heard my cry. You know, there's a great thing about this Psalm, David. I love the fact that waiting patiently is an action by us. Something we've got to do, we've got to wait patiently on God. And at the time of his distress, the Lord turns to David and hears our cry, because that's something we can apply to our lives. Absolutely. Absolutely. Think of all the things that the Lord has done in your own life when he's turned to you and rescued you. And Jim had also mentioned about the lack of stability that man has with their feet of clay, you know. Were easily knocked over. In the second verse it says, he also brought me up out of the horrible pit out of the miry clay and set my feet upon a rock and established my steps. So we have that action in the first verse. We have that waiting patiently. We have the Lord turning to us. And in the second verse, he has rescued us and placed us in a place of stability. But not just any place of stability. The rock. Jesus Christ himself. We stand on the rock. And you know, sometimes if you stumble on the rock, you're only going to fall as far as the rock. He's still there for us. And it reminded me, as the Lord would speak to Peter, and we know this verse very well. And I also say to you that you are Peter. And then Jesus starts to talk about himself. And on this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. How wonderful. In the grand scheme of things, not long after that, we would be rushed into a new covenant between God and man. And we think about that time this morning where Jesus would be with his disciples and he would have a meal and break bread with them. And that has given us the opportunity to join this new and better covenant. And we know what happened at the cross, and we'll be reminding ourselves of that this morning. We're going to sing the first verse of What Kind of Love Is This, and then I'm going to ask Paul Allen to come up and give thanks for the bread. Give thanks for the bread. Thanks.
Thank you, Gordon. Lord Jesus, we come before you in humility and open our hearts to you today. We remember that John wrote that if we claim to be without sin, we deceived ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. We confess that we have often done things that are not pleasing to you, Lord. Help us rid of anything that is hindering our walk with you. We know that we are your beloved children and have received you into our hearts and life. Having accepted your death as penalty for our sinfulness, the price you paid covered us for all time, and our one desire is to live for you. As we take this bread representing your life that was broken for us, we remember and celebrate your faithfulness to us and to all who will receive you. We cannot begin to understand the agonizing suffering of your crucifixion, yet you took that pain for us. You died for us. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you that your death gave us life, abundant life now, and eternal life forever. As you instructed your disciples, we too receive this bread in remembrance of you. Amen.
Amen.
we're just going to sing the second verse of What Kind of Love Is This? And then I'm going to ask Dave Allen to come and pray for the wine.
Before I pray, I'd just like to read a short bit from the Bible that sort of answers the question, why do we do this? Why do we come on a Sunday, and why do we take the bread and the wine? And it's Mark 22-24, I think really answers it so simply. As they were eating, Jesus took a small loaf of bread and asked God's blessing on it and broke it in pieces and gave it to them and said, "Eat, this is my body." He then took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it and gave it to them, and they all drank from it. And he said to them, "This is my blood poured out for many, sealing the new agreement between us, God and man." We now give thanks for the wine. Father, we thank you that you gave us such a simple way to remember you, such a simple way. Nothing fancy, no big way to do it, nothing that was complicated or difficult. You simply took bread for your body and wine for your blood that you shed in Calvary that gives and takes away our sin. Your blood was shed for our sin and covers it forever. Without the blood, Lord, we could not go on. We could not come into your presence. We can only thank you for the fact that this has been given to us as this way, and that every time we do this, we think of you, and that we can ask for our sins to be forgiven, and we know that because you shed your blood in Calvary, our sins are forgiven. We thank you for this. Amen.
Let's just remain seated and sing the last verse of What Kind of Love Is This?
Sons of Jesus.
in a wee moment, I'm just going to ask if you have any children at the creche, if you could go and collect them, as it allows the folks to get the church lunch ready. And while that's happening, we're going to stand and sing the whole song, What Kind of Love Is This Again? And then afterwards, I'm going to ask Gordon Muir to come and close in prayer.
Good morning, everyone. Lovely to see all of you. Just as we come to prayer, I've been very challenged this morning just about the idols in my own heart. I wonder if you have too. Hearing Jim preach again just has brought a very sharp, that sword of the Spirit, hasn't it, into our hearts, that we see things that we didn't see before we heard the scriptures. Isn't that the case? And we're aware of where we need to walk more circumspectly according to the word of God and be careful of those things that we love and we worship. The hymn we sang earlier really spoke to me as well. Not the labor of my hands can fulfill thy law's demands. Could my zeal no respite know? Could my tears forever flow, all could never sin erase. Thou must save and save by grace. Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word this morning. Thank you for the sense of your presence this morning. Thank you for the Holy Spirit with us today to enliven that word that we've heard and to make it powerful in our own hearts, to cause us to move forward in the will of God, to be willing to turn from idols, to be willing to be have done with lesser things that are that corrupt and pollute our hearts. Oh, Father, help us as we go forward now to not only have heard your word, to be, but to be those who do it, to put it into practice. Lord, you have made us for your glory. You have saved us through faith in Jesus Christ for your glory. And you call us, therefore, to live out that great salvation that Christ has worked into us, Jesus Christ in us, able to live the God life through us. Lord, help us to be willing participants, to be willing to cast down, tear down every favorite idol that we have that stands in the way of your glory. Lord, help us in these things this week that truly Jesus may be Lord of our lives. And being Lord, that the Holy Spirit may work through us, may form Christ in us, that Jesus might be seen in us and be heard on our lips and be seen in our faces, and that his touch may be felt through our lives as we love one another with the love that is of God, that love might fill hearts that are washed and cleansed, that worship God only, and that all that corrupts and pollutes and steals the throne of our hearts from our Jesus, that all things might be put away, and that Christ only, Christ alone, might reign in us for God's glory, and that we might shine for him in works of good deeds that he's prepared in advance, that all of this might come to pass even this week as we step out to follow Jesus afresh. In his name, we pray. Amen.
Just when you're ready, the food is ready, and if you just go through the door where Andrew's standing at the moment to pick up your food and drinks, thank you.